Mr. Chairman, I will speak in English. If you could let me know the time horizon that you have a plan, and two particular things from me. I represent not the chamber nor any other party. I have tried to bring the chamber here and also Sri Lanka's advisor on trade, Dr. Rasin Sali here, but I have failed because they would not want to come nor even send their written submissions to this commission. So having said that, what I say here you may not like, but they are my own and not anybody else. So if you can tell me my timing, I will send a written submission outside. Timing?
Yes, 20 minutes you have and 5 minutes for
okay. I first wish you to focus that trade policy cannot go without a hand-in-hand link up with investments policy. So I'm going to cover both trade and investments together, and I ask you that whether in the longer term your value of your submissions will focus both on trade and investment, specifically as you are looking at international trade. I will deal with this in four quick aspects. First is governance, which is something that not many people in the private sector would ever look at. Mine is first is quite a bit of thinking on governance side. Secondly, I also would like to take the opposite of governance, which is controls and licensing procedures, what comes from the external implications on governance. And then I would like to do some controversial policy ideas, and finally some rounding up things about trade, which you have already heard about FTAs and other things. Firstly, on governance, I think all products and services coming within the policy must ensure, if it's international trade, it might apply to local trade, but I'm concerned that no product or service, either imported, exported, in use, applied, or if being a service, experienced negatively impact, damage or hurt the following criteria. I think that should be a policy part of the country. I mean, if something damages these particular fundamentals, then that should not receive any form of consideration other than under special circumstances. Where special circumstances would require, I'd like to say it at this stage, any special requirements. There are some special provision options which I will bring out at certain stages, or certain subsidies or certain benefits. They must be transparently handled. It should be placed in parliament, debated with public participation, and made it into a very open, transparent. It should not be one-on-one, because I can tell you enough of opportunities or experiences where one-on-one has led to rent seeking investments and trade. And that is not in the interest of the country. So the products, what I'm talking, must be legal and within the constitutional framework. If something is against that, obviously it's out. Second, sovereignty should not be affected. It should not be something that will damage the possibilities of equality and inclusiveness in this country. If something, because we are talking about services also in the international trade, that is also, you must have at least to examine what does it do to inclusiveness and equity. Sustainability, national resource preservation, the exploitation of national resources must be allowed, but subject to it. Then health and safety of the people, specifically focusing on young, youth, women, vulnerable society and disabled segments of this society who are subjected to the, if there is something, then it must not be allowed. If it damages in some way, because we are talking about, because I'm taking services, I'm going to be more broad, the pluralistic ethno-religious heritage practices, because bringing a wrong Quran or bringing a statue of Buddha with something, those things also must be embedded in. the national identity and the national image, if there is something that is going to impact, brand image is something that a country must have, and that must be looked at. The local value addition limitations, if there is something that is going to limit the local value addition options, that must also be examined. So these conditions must be specific, and there should be a bar for any trade of this unless specifically approved. That's my first part. Now, to actively adopt this policy, there must be a code of conduct, ethics and business standards. To internalize this, in respect of international trade, anybody engaging in international trade or services must be a member of a local sector association. Now, this is happening in many countries, and the Bandula is aware of this, is something that has been there before. You must be a member of a association which is affiliated to a chamber which is willing to take the responsibility for assurance of those negative factors are not there, and those factors, as well as to ensure that the code of ethics is upheld and plea both pecuniary, as well as they even go to the extent of taking whatever legal steps of action against those individuals who break it. Now, their marketing methods, distribution and communications must come under the control and review and oversight of this body. I don't want an outside body. Their own body must take concern that they are not making wrongful. And finally, what is going to come into all professional accountants from the 17th of July, the non-compliance with laws and regulations, you are supposed to respond. And I believe that that should be, and whistleblowing, these two aspects must be embedded in the standards in whatever it comes in. Now, looking at the second side of this, now, similarly, if there is any artificial control through standards, pricing, I would suggest a standards and pricing and policy commission, which looks at all the negative ones that are there, must again be done with the parliamentary approval. Only can you put in, no individual minister or individual executive or individual thing must be allowed to impact upon this. So there must be an open, transparent process for these. Policy may state that and must be implemented that way. Price controls, controls through paratariffs or unfair standards, or even the lead, you give some affirmative action which is converts into a subsidy in the long term. If affirmative action, I will come into the procurement in the next part within this, but that is specifically must be limited by time bar. Now, it is important that you look at, whilst you are looking at international trade and thing, you must also look at the role that the procurement commission can play. I think it's very important that now the constitution has accepted and created a procurement commission, and the procurement commission's own guidelines, how they affirmatively support local enterprises, but there must be some minimum threshold of a local production. I mean, you can't give this to everybody. If you are giving a benefit, it must be at a certain level with certain value addition. Now, as a promotional guideline, giving some benefit to a local enterprise, in pricing terms only, for local value addition, local economic and social empowerment, micro, small, medium people, technology transfer, economic empowerment of backward areas, I mean, though these are usual things, but what I'm saying is it must be transparent, not individual, it must be transparent, done across. So the National Procurement Commission must, whilst doing that, must do three other very important facts. You have to have a policy on unsolicited proposals. There must be this impacts in international trade and local people. Bilateral country negotiations led, things must also be transparently done. When things are presented in the form of packages of credits and debts and loan facilities, those factors must be separated. Now, what happens is you hide the international trade transaction within a trade finance package. Now, you must be able to this must be separated by the procurement commission, or somebody must lay rules where you have to separate these two. Because you can ride the local industry down. There are enough vocations about the transport sector to railways where these things have come up. Then coming to the primary core should be export value addition in my books. So you must give your focus to export oriented objectives, because this has a bearing upon our monetary stability of this country is going to be impacted unless we go back to strengthening this side. So enhancement of local value addition. Here I might make a few unacceptable remarks or whatever you may think. But provision of technology. To me, what I'm saying is anybody should be allowed to come, provided there is a sufficient degree of, I would differ with my previous presenter, if there is somebody with value that can be added on a sustainable basis to stopping to say the local people can do it over 10 years, but if there is these factors, if there is enhancement of a minimum local value addition, you might say that that level can be fitted. It might be 80% local value addition to 25%. I mean, dependent upon, that must process must also be transparent. Provision of technology and best practices. That is what we are lacking, and that must be brought. Links to market access and supply chains. If anybody is bringing us if you bring up one of these big firms into supply chain, they may come for one product, but the supply chain will pick up. If you look at global case studies, I can give you examples if needed later. You bring in a value chain, one link will develop so many other links. So that is the way that Eastern trade and value has increased. Human resource development, people who come here with addition to, if they can. Innovativeness, quality, product development, that kind of improving the domestic business climate, ease of business. If they bring in a new processes that bring, there should be no bar. Here I would say, these are my controversial points, which are, if there is a minimum local value addition, specifically higher value addition items in backward areas of this country where there is lack of employment, lack of livelihood opportunities, lack of where their living standards are low, if their people are going to bring in, as long as it's within those illegal activities, there should be no bar upon a foreign, just because international trade is not. But they must be monitored, they must be set standard, and what I bring today, what is called recall benefits. Now, income tax or any concessions given must have a recall. I have done some investigations for investigating bodies now. You have been a commissioner, but I can tell you hundreds of cases which are now coming up where benefit is given for one, they do something else and they continue. There must be monitoring, oversight and recall, that you have a right of recall of any of these benefits that are given. I even go on to say, if those factors like local value addition, transfer of technology, those things I said is there, government should give them only one thing, no tax benefits or anything, give them land grants and give them basic infrastructure. If somebody has a, say wants to come to Bibile and do a project, the government should give a land grant and basic infrastructure. That's all they should give, and get them monitored. Important thing is they must be monitored and recall benefits must be there if they are not adding value. Now in this thing, I think there are two or three sectors which you may not like. Shipping, to me, maritime and logistics, shipping area, fisheries, especially internal fisheries, if in-house fisheries or fisheries outside, the present bars that are there through regulatory mechanisms must be removed as a case in point. Because they are essential. If you bring in a big shipping company like Maersk or something, with them will come lots of other investors. If you can bring one of them, this present bar of giving them not more than 40% is, I think, It's been controlled by a few rent-seeking private sector businesses. They are convinced in the government on nationalism that it should not be opened out. This, I think, is a very, very foolish idea. If you want international trade to add value, set standards upon them to value addition that is required out of them. I know an argument came that day in your presentation when this was done about whether barbers should come or whether IT people should come from India. If you say that you can bring any barber or anything, that the local value addition is 85%. I mean, I will say if you want to open a barber shop, if it's going to add local value or 85%, and with a recall facility and subject to proof annually, why not give them a license to bring their barbers here and start so that they are adding value here of 85%. That means they have to employ local people and train them. Look at the training and transfer. IT sector. I totally disagree with the trying to stop people coming in here. If there is, the problem is we are looking at it isolated about people and the job. But let us focus on value addition. If somebody has a ability to add value, I say take it. Because cross-border gains in value, in sustainable terms, with a recall, is I think the policy focus should be. Then very quickly to FTAs. I totally support FTAs. Where FTAs drive two things. FTAs drive business establishments here which will use Sri Lanka for chain links. If an FTA, not reciprocity, yes. No, I'll finish within the 2 minutes. No reciprocity is my view. You don't have, if you go the reciprocity, they give you this, I will give you that. That will not work. If we bring with this facility value addition as the base, I think then for me para tariffs must go. Commodity levies must be used only to smoothen out our local production. If the tomatoes are not available, tomatoes need to be brought. You bring it only during the, what happens here is you put a commodity levy, it remains throughout. Support with the troughs and values. You can do this. I think Central Bank has done some beautiful studies. Using those, you can. So, finally, VAT and taxes must be lowered and the base increase, because the VAT at the current level is not something that people will think. And flexible links, which are rent-seeking, must be replaced by rule-based, clarity-driven, transparent, specific, consistently applied policy conditions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
I took the absurd example, but I to drive my point home, sir.
Nothing like that.
IT.
IT, of course. But how to value the value addition in the providing services other than IT and other services?
Local value addition, sir.
Yes.
If the amount of money, let's say an IT business,
yes,
right, wants to come here, okay, they will be lowering the argument now is, our people are getting 50,000, Indian workers will come here and do at 25,000, right? So let them bring 25,000, so long as the local value addition, that is, that the 25,000 people won't come, their total turnover, if you say 50% local value addition, either they have to pay rent for somebody's building or they have to pay for their local supplies, transportation, they make this an export hub, they make this the, our telecommunications are going to benefit.
Subsidies.
Whatever, you take the total value addition of that enterprise. If you say you have to have every year 50%. Now to me, look at all the Chinese restaurants that have opened. Now have they got permission? They are coming here as tourists and they are doing it. You cannot stop this by regulations. All you have to do is, okay, Chinese, you want to open a Chinese factory, somebody might not be the Chinese fellows are coming here. The people are, I have seen the paper, they are complaining that the Chinese traders are, they are coming here and doing trading. So if there is a, if there is a market and we are not satisfying it, that's our fault. I will look at it this way. It is, you have to do two things here. First is, you have to take away the political power of the, go back to the era where the chief executive accounting officer is the secretary of the ministry. That 1972 amendment must go away. Right? If that goes away, and you endow that, public institutions will develop with independence. If that is allowed, problem is, it's chicken and egg. As long as that institutions are not built, institutions are controlled, rent is what is sought through institutional failures, what you are saying will happen. Now you are talking about steel. I am in a part of an investigation on steel, so I cannot talk about it. But what you are saying, I know much more than what you have, having seen the papers inside. So I have analyzed it. It is all a part of the political power which has taken away the...
So, to these buildings. There are no sprinkler systems, there are no fire doors, there are no exits, and yet the buildings are being approved.
Why is this surcharge being surcharge provisions of the new audit bill being prevented by the secretaries? Because what they say is true. If the secretaries have to, why should the secretaries take accountability when they don't have the power of the decision making? So you have to restore that. Public institution development will have to happen, obviously. Yeah. So along with this, but because you don't have it, you must not stop internal value addition. That is my point. Thank you.